Take a moment and look at your skin. Your skin could be light or dark, it could be dry, it could be oily, it could be rough or smooth, it probably has hair growing out of some parts but not of others. Skin kind of weirds me out if I think about it too much. It's like you've got these strands of dead cells that are growing out of your skin and you have to cut them because they get too long sometimes. Just so strange. But one thing's true for all of us. We all have skin that separates our bodies from the external world. Our skin is our first layer of protection, whether that's from harmful UV rays or pathogens that can make us sick. Our skin helps us regulate our temperature and provides sensation as we interact with the world around us. So in this video, we're gonna zoom into the skin and take a look at all the different structures and layers that make up our skin and what they do. So we'll just use my skin as an example. So we'll just zoom in here on it. Before we get into our diagram of the skin, let's talk about the four main functions of the integumentary system, or of the skin. I use the acronym PTSD to help me remember those. They're protection, thermoregulation, sensation, and D for vitamin D synthesis. Let's actually start with that last one, vitamin D synthesis. Our skin needs sunlight in order to make vitamin D from its component parts. That's really weird if you think about it. There's no other molecule that our bodies have to make where we need sunlight for. Now, plants, of course, need sunlight for photosynthesis to occur, but for humans or mammals in general, that's really rare that we need sunlight in order for a particular reaction to occur. But this is the weird exception. Our skin needs sunlight in order to make vitamin D that our bodies need. The other three functions, protection, thermoregulation, and sensation, those are gonna pop up throughout the rest of the video. So as we go through this, think about how each structure and each layer that we talk about, how does that help promote these three functions? Now, there's really three main layers of the skin. We have the epidermis, the dermis, and the hypodermis. The word dermis just means skin in Greek, which is why it's in all three of these layers. Epi means above, so epidermis means above the dermis, or more superficial than the dermis layer. The dermis layer just means skin, and hypo means under, so hypodermis would be the layer under the main skin layer. So all three of these layers are really named by their location. Epidermis outside, we got the dermis, and then inside we have the hypodermis. And of course, if we went deeper than that, we would come to muscle and bone and then the internal organs. The epidermis, or the most superficial layer, is made of stratified epithelial tissue. Epithelial tissue is those layers of tissue where the cells are packed really tightly together, and stratified just means that there's more than one layer. In fact, there's lots of layers of cells in the epidermis. And the fact that it has so many layers kind of gets back at our first function, protection. Having lots of layers means we have a thicker layer of protection from things outside of the body. There are five main strata in the epidermis. Starting with the outside and working in, we have the stratum corneum, the stratum lucidum, the stratum granulosum, the stratum spinosum, and the stratum basal. Think basal like basement or the lower part of something. And out of all of these layers, there's only one layer of cells that are living still. That's the stratum basal. All the other layers, the cells are dead or starting to die off. Most of the outside layers of your skin are just dead cells. But that's important. Dead cells are really good at protection. So that stratum basal layer, those cells are dividing and growing more and more skin. But as they start to die off, they start to move to outside layers. The cells from the stratum basal layer will move up to the stratum spinosum, then to the stratum granulosum, lucidum, and corneum. Now, as these cells die, they start to fill with a protein called keratin. Keratin is really important. It's found in your skin, but it's also found in your nails and in your hair. Any animals that have scales, those are filled with a lot of keratin. And one of the great things about keratin is that it's resistant to water. It's really important that our skin is waterproof so that we can regulate the amount of water that's inside of our body. Now, over time, those dead cells in the stratum corneum layer are going to be shed. And look around, if your house is dusty, a lot of that dust is your dead skin cells. And one other interesting fact, not every part of your skin has all five of these layers. In fact, the stratum lucidum is only found in thick skin, such as in your fingertips or the soles of your feet. In other words, the parts of your body that have to interact with rough surfaces that can damage the skin, they've got an extra layer, that stratum lucidum, to help them. Now, besides these epithelial cells, another type of cell found in the skin are melanocytes. And melanocytes are a special cell that produce the pigment molecule called melanin. And that molecule melanin is responsible for differences in skin color. My skin's pretty light, which just means that my melanocytes don't make a lot of melanin. But I do have some parts that have more melanin than others. For example, you can see some moles on my arm here. And those moles are just little patches of skin where the melanocytes are a little bit overproductive compared to the parts of the skin around it. And if your skin is darker, that means your melanocytes make more melanin. It doesn't mean that you have more melanocytes, it just means your melanocytes produce more melanin than somebody with lighter skin. Another factor that affects melanin production is sunlight. UV radiation stimulates melanocytes to produce more melanin. which is why somebody's skin gets darker after they go tanning. That UV radiation stimulates melanocytes to make more melanin. But don't go tanning too much, because UV radiation can also damage DNA and cause melanoma, which is a cancer of the melanocytes, where they start to grow uncontrollably and can damage cells throughout the body. Now, just deep to the epidermis is the dermis. The dermis is primarily dense, irregular connective tissue. And remember, connective tissue is filled with two main types of fibers: elastin, which makes it stretchy and movable, and collagen, which makes it tough and strong. Now, the dermis is filled with lots of other structures, such as hair follicles or sensory neurons, sweat glands, oil glands. We're gonna talk about all of that here in a second. Now, just deep to the dermis is the hypodermis. And the hypodermis consists of adipose tissue, or fat cells. This is the layer of the skin that's going to store fat molecules. It's also a great thermal insulator. So when we think about the skin regulating our temperature, this is one of the ways that it does that. All of these layers, and this adipose layer especially, are going to help trap heat in or prevent our thermal energy from escaping to our surroundings. Another way that we thermoregulate is through our blood vessels. We have blood vessels traveling all throughout this hypodermis layer, and they extend up into the dermis and up into the stratum basal of the epidermis. And blood vessels, of course, are how oxygen and other nutrients are delivered to tissue cells so they get the energy that they need. This place where oxygen, carbon dioxide, nutrient exchange occurs are called blood capillaries. And they're really thin, which allows carbon dioxide and oxygen to move back and forth from the blood vessel to the tissue cells. So how do we use blood vessels to thermoregulate? Well, our body can regulate how much blood goes through all the different capillaries throughout the body. If our bodies are too warm, we'll expand those capillaries and push more blood to them so that that warm blood can release its energy to the surroundings through our skin. But if our body temperature is too cold, those capillaries will constrict and there'll be less blood flowing through them, and that way our warm blood won't lose any of its thermal energy to the surroundings. We also have sweat glands throughout our skin, which are gonna help us to thermoregulate. Sweat is primarily water, but it has other substances in it as well. And that sweat substance is gonna be released or excreted into these long coiled tubes that connect to the surface of the skin in what we call a pore. We have sweat glands all throughout the body, but they're more concentrated in parts that sweat more, such as your armpits. And the sweat helps us thermoregulate because whenever it's hot outside, instead of that heat warming up our bodies, that heat will cause our sweat to evaporate. And the act of our sweat evaporating is sort of a preventative measure from us getting that heat from the surroundings. Another structure we have is the hair. Hairs are made of many cells, very similar to the epidermis cells. They're keratinized, dead epithelial cells. If you follow the shaft all the way down into the hair follicle, which is just the indentation down into the dermis that the hair sits in, we have something called the hair papilla. And the hair papilla, just like the stratum basal layer of the epidermis, is the only part of the hair that blood vessels reach up to. These are the cells in the hair that are undergoing mitosis and dividing, which makes our hair grow. And as our hair grows out, it pushes the dead cells out and out and out, creating these long hair strands. Our hair doesn't grow from the tips of the hair, it grows from the papilla of the hair, which is deep into the skin. And you can see those tiny blood vessels entering into the hair papilla to provide that papilla with oxygen and nutrients so that those cells can grow. Now, attached to the hair follicle in the diagram is a sebaceous gland. Sebaceous glands are often associated with hair follicles, but they don't have to be. They can also just excrete their substance straight onto the surface of the skin. And instead of making sweat, sebaceous glands excrete something called sebum, which is the oily substance that our skin produces. That oil, or sebum, lubricates the skin and also has some antibacterial properties, which gets back to our idea of protection. Now, sebaceous glands are more common on the face than anywhere else in the body, but they have a problem, and that's that they can get clogged, especially during puberty. If a sebaceous gland produces too much sebum, that can clog the pore, and that sebum will build up and it'll start to turn red and produce a sore that we call acne. So if you find yourself breaking out in zits, blame your sebaceous glands. Also attached to hair follicles are tiny muscles called the erector pili muscles. The erector pili muscles, whenever they contract, will make the hair stand on end. They also produce goosebumps in the skin. So whenever you get cold, those erector pili muscles will contract, they'll make your hair stand up, and the purpose of that is to help us be a little bit warmer. Finally, all throughout the dermis, we have sensory neurons. We have sensory neuron receptors for detecting all kinds of things. We have mechanoreceptors, which detect pressure and touch sensations. We have thermoreceptors, which detect temperature. And these sensory neurons connect to all kinds of structures. They connect to hair. Think about a time when somebody's pulled on your hair and it really hurt. Well, we've got sensory neurons that connect to those hair papilla. We don't see them in this diagram, that send a signal up to our brain and say, hey, this hurts. We also have motor neurons on our erector pili muscles to tell them to contract whenever we're feeling cold. So sensory neurons are found all throughout the skin, which helps with sensation, one of our functions of the integumentary system. All right, so those are some of the primary structures and layers of the skin. Let's do a quick recap now. There are four functions of the integumentary system. I use the acronym PTSD, protection, thermoregulation, sensation, and vitamin D synthesis. Our skin needs sunlight in order to synthesize vitamin D. We have three primary layers, the epidermis, dermis, and hypodermis. The epidermis is stratified epithelial cells. The epidermis contains five strata, the stratum corneum, stratum lucidum, stratum granulosum, stratum spinosum, stratum basal, and the stratum basal is the only of those layers that has living cells that are undergoing mitosis and dividing. There are also melanocytes, which produce the pigment melanin, which makes skin dark. And the most superficial strata contain the protein keratin, which makes our skin waterproof. The dermis layer contains dense, irregular connective tissue, which contains collagen and elastin fibers. And the dermis is filled with all kinds of structures, such as sweat glands and hair follicles. Underneath that is the hypodermis, which is the adipose or fat cell layer, which in addition to storing fat, helps us keep warm. We have blood vessels throughout all of the hypodermis and dermis, which are going to provide cells with the nutrients that they need in order to survive. We also use our blood cells to help thermoregulate. Blood vessels expand to increase blood flow to the surface of the skin so we can give off heat and stay cool. Or they'll constrict to prevent blood from reaching the skin as much so that we can keep all that warm blood inside and stay warm. We have sweat glands that make sweat to help us stay cool. We have hairs, which are mostly dead cells. The hair papilla is where mitosis happens, producing new cells that make our hair grow longer. For those of you that are blessed with hair on your head. Sebaceous glands produce sebum, which is an oil that's going to lubricate our skin. And acne is whenever those sebaceous glands get clogged. We have erector pili muscles, which help our hair stand on end and produces goosebumps. And finally, there's sensory neurons all throughout our skin, which helps us detect and observe the world around us. One more interesting thing about the skin before we go, tattoos. If you were to draw on the surface of your skin or in that epidermis layer, that's not going to last very long because we're always shedding cells from the epidermis layer. Those cells are dying and they're going to eventually shed off from the stratum corneum. So if we want something permanent, it's going to have to be deeper than the epidermis. It's got to get down into the dermis. So if you ever get a tattoo, like the skyline of Memphis, for example, the tattoo gun has to inject the ink down into the dermis layer because the dermis layer never gets shed. Any ink molecules that make it to the dermis layer, they're going to pretty much stay there as long as you live. They could fade over time or the body could break them down some, but they're not going to go anywhere. So tattoo ink has to make it down into the dermis. Where's Alondra's nose? Yeah! Where's Alondra's mouth? Where's Alondra's ears? Yeah. Yeah. Where's Alondra's skin? Yeah, the skin covers all of those parts. Your skin's everywhere. Wait, bye-bye.